It's not good. Wait a minute. I need an agenda.
Leave it.
Okay. Oh, wait. No, wait. Hang on. I think I threw it in my computer. Okay.
We're going to call the March the 8th, 2011 Board of Mayor and Alderman meeting to order. And we're going to start out with the invocation. And I'm going to ask Alderman Barnhill if he would give the invocation tonight.
Would you bow? Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer tonight. Thank you for this day, for this community. We're truly a blessed community. We recognize that you are the giver of those blessings, and we give you the thanks for them. We ask that you be with each of us tonight as aldermen, as we make the decisions that ultimately affect the citizens of the city of Franklin. We give us spiritual wisdom and guidance. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item 4 on the agenda is grievances or statements from citizens on issues that are not on the agenda tonight. Is there anyone who would like to? Yes, sir. Come to the podium and state your name and right over here.
Would you
see
that those nice
ladies
down there get one?
Yeah, especially
the one
tight.
Well,
and we'll give you all these in just a minute, too. Okay. Go ahead. Your name, sir?
Bill McDaniel. I'm a 28-year resident of Williamson County, and I own a medical practice for that length of time, and I'm an 11-year resident of Franklin, live in Caronbridge, and something that Mr. Stuckey and myself, I've introduced this to him, but it's been an issue that I hadn't been able to make the meetings. But I'd like to have the city consider the idea of actually instituting an actual use sewer charge, because if you look at the second page there of that document, you can see that my winter average use is $25, even if you add in a couple of months in the fall, but my summer watering use is $113 average, topping $160 sometimes, and every bit of that extra water goes on my lawn, but not in the sanitary sewer. And we do have a stormwater coverage if any of it runs into the street, but the city is really billing based on water usage when we water, but the sewer is not actually, it's none of it's going through the sewer facility. So I don't see, and other cities have done this, where you can take the winter 6-month average, which is your actual use, and just make it a flat rate. And I think that's fair. That's the only fair way to do it, because for the city to charge me for sanitary sewer treatment for that extra water is services not rendered by the city. And I don't believe that another tap or, you know, that requires a lot of expense, it requires extra billing, requires extra meter reading. I think it's so easy to do that if you take October through March, and just after somebody has 1 year of service, just simply after a full year, you have to pay it the first year, but then you could take the off-season and 6-month average and just make a flat rate until that family moves, and then the next family would have to have a year of service to do that. But it's a very simple in-house maneuver. Other cities have done it. And I just feel like that, you know, when you're trying to get a lawn started, that, you know, there's a lot of extra money that really is not, the city shouldn't be necessarily getting that extra. And I'd just like you all to consider that, because it's not hard to figure the differences are there. I apologize for a typo on that paper, but I just feel like that it's something that is just a logical maneuver. The city's obviously quite concerned about, you know, doing everything accurate for its citizens, and I think that's just a step that you should consider, and I appreciate the chance to bring it up to you.
So, thank you for coming. Make sure we have your name and address.
Okay.
If you can just leave it somewhere for us. Next is a communication from Williamson County Mayor and Williamson County Commission. Anyone here that want to make a comment from them? I don't see anyone. Next is approval of minutes for February 8th, 2011 work session, February 8th, 2011 Board of Mayor and Aldermen, February 24th special BOMA meeting, and February 24th executive session. Is there a motion to approve?
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? Passes unanimously. Next is number seven, recognitions, proclamation of purchasing month. And we'll defer that till next time. Because I don't have a proclamation in front of me.
What a relief.
What a relief. And I knew this was one that was really going to get your attention.
Yes. I'm okay with you not proclaiming anything.
We may need a special call.
Ditto. We'll do it at the next meeting. We'll read that proclamation. So next is miscellaneous reports. I can't believe it.
Some things never change.
I will recognize Alderman Skinner.
Thank you, Mayor. Want to share with our viewers and audience that the Civil War Roundtable presentation for Sunday, March 13th at 3 o'clock at the Williamson County Library is a special treat. There will be excerpts from the play Scaife that's based on the escapades of General Van Dorn and a local lady in Spring Hill during the Civil War. So you will actually get to see excerpts from this play this Sunday, 3 o'clock, Williamson County Library. So y'all come, it'll be a real treat.
Moving on. Thank you. The consent agenda, all items under the consent agenda are deemed to be non-controversial and routine in nature by the governing body. These are items 19 through 29. Does anyone want to remove anything from the consent agenda? If not, I look for a motion to approve.
Move approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposition? See none, pass unanimously. Old business, public hearing, consideration of an ordinance 2010-20, an ordinance to rezone 20.001 acres to be included within the scientific research overlay zoning district for property located at the northeast corner of Macatcher Parkway and Franklin Road. Is there any comment? Seeing none, the public hearing is closed. Is there a motion for approval?
Move approval.
Second.
Alderman McClendon made the motion. Alderman Peterson seconded.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Say none. Pass unanimously. This is another public hearing. Consideration of the Ordinance 2010-80 is amended, an ordinance to establish the special assessments for the sanitary sewer improvements in the Monticello subdivision area. This is the second final reading. This is now, public hearing is now open. Would anyone like to make comments? Please step to the podium and give your thing there.
I'm Jay Wade. I've been working, I'm at 123 Jefferson. I've been working on sewers for Monticello since 2002. First with the county, then with the city. That's been a lot of meetings, and I am not happy with the way things have turned out. When we talked previously to city officials from past administrations, they were very cordial and encouraged us to be annexed to become full Roman citizens in the city of Franklin. They said they would help us make the transition as easy as possible. They said they would. They produced the Monticello sewer study to tell us how much the sewer was going to cost. They said they would waive all the engineering and design fees. They said they would waive all the connection fees. And that wasn't just Alderman McClendon. That was others also. And then after we had all those assurances, the neighborhood held a vote. The Monticello Homeowners Association, which is a voluntary organization, held a neighborhood vote. In order to participate in that vote, a resident had to be a current dues-paying member, which meant some people couldn't vote. I personally did not vote. After the vote came in, we had, of the 108 houses that would eventually be in the assessment district, we had 49 affirmative votes, or 60% of the, it was 49 votes, and that's 45% of the total, or 60% of the actual votes cast. Now, if we knew then what we know now, that annexation vote would be a lot different. I had previously made a presentation before the board on the ARRA funding issue and telling how Monticello was a perfect project and the perfect window of opportunity, but the city wouldn't apply. And the most egregious aspect of that to me was the Simmons Ridge sewer line, a 24-inch sewer main that went over to South Carruthers to expedite development. A sewer line the city had repeatedly said would have to be paid for by developers. Now that sewer line is paid 40% by stimulus money and 60% by sewer ratepayers. And then the city has the audacity to say standing by their commitments to Monticello was a burden on those ratepayers. As we continued down the path, our design engineer says we would require 25,000 square yards of pavement replacement, not resurfacing, pavement replacement. At the May 14th, 2009 CIP meeting, the following statement was made. Unlike Highgate, paving will be necessary as Monticello includes sewer in the roadway up to 20 feet deep. And that CIP meeting is where the city first agreed to pick up $450,000 of our paving costs. Now, our paving costs have steadily increased. At the first estimate, January 2007 was $350,000. By April 2008, it was $400,000. By February 2009, it was $450,560. After the job is complete, our pavement restoration charges are $540,000. We had a public hearing on June 9th, 2009 to start off the assessment district. The city sent out several documents, one of which was this assessment district comparison chart. And on that chart, on the Monticello column, in the line that says project cost excluded from assessment, it says street paving. It does not say repaving. It does not say resurfacing. It says excluded street paving. June 12th, after the meeting, city sends out another memorandum answering all our questions. And in those answers to questions, they state, with the lines being in the streets at this depth, the street paving is much more extensive than just a patch. Let me say that again. The street repaving is much more extensive than just a patch. When the city went to bid, they took the paving cost and broke it into two line items. One was resurfacing, and the other was labeled permanent pavement patch, 5 inches asphalt binder. Now, that's the base course of asphalt that the resurface goes on top of. And now the city only wants to pay the resurfacing charge. The other $327,000 of permanent pavement patch they don't want to consider as part of paving. Now, just yesterday, Mr. Stuckey sent an email to one of the residents trying to explain that situation. And in that email, he says the city committed to paying for repaving of the streets in Monticello neighborhood, not $450,000 in paving costs, even though that comparison chart said paving costs excluded. And he goes on to say, the estimated cost of paving was $450,000. The actual cost of the resurfacing came in through the bid process at $212,000. Well, that's an apples to oranges comparison. And then continues, street resurfacing was not provided in any one of the other sanitary sewer assessment districts. Well, it wasn't acquired in any of the others. It wasn't promised in any of the others. But in all the others, they are on the city resurfacing list in the next couple of years. Then this past January 11th, I came down here to another public hearing for another sewer assessment district. And I made the plea that all the connection fees for all the assessment districts be waived for a period of 2 years so that elderly widows might have the opportunity to afford to connect. My comments were ignored. But that same night, there was a string of developers, their lawyers and lobbyists that come to the table and ask for relief from their impact fees. And the board seemed amenable to at least some of their requests. The contrast in situations was stark. And when it came down to setting the final charges for our assessment district, we had to coach our aldermen to the fact that our engineering fees were still buried in the total. We want to thank Alderman McClendon for getting those fees removed as was originally promised. He offered up other amendments to help rectify our situation, but in the end, we did not get the votes. So after all these years, in the end analysis, City of Franklin has reneged on waiving all our connection fees. City of Franklin has reneged on picking up $450,000 of our paving cost. City of Franklin has acted as an antagonist through the entire process. And rather than feeling like a full Roman citizen, I feel like an abused refugee. And now, as a new citizen of Franklin, I look out and what do I see? It becomes apparent to me what you get depends on where you live. If you live downtown, all the infrastructure improvements are for free, paid 100% by a government, no assessment district required. You go out to another part of town and they'll have an assessment district for sewer, but 56% of the construction costs are paid by government. You come to Monticello and 0% is paid by government. We have to pay for the whole thing ourselves, and we're not even sure it's going to work right. Thank you for your time.
Mayor, Alderman Jim Mays, past president and former president for 3 years of our association. So here we are, finally coming to closure after these many years of having good conversations. I forwarded some comments to all of you earlier. You may not have had a chance to reflect upon them, but I thought I would articulate those for the record here tonight. Jay brings up some good points. I think it's been a process that we've gone through. It's not been perfect, but what relationship is ever perfect? So I think what I'd like to do is kind of focus on intent on specifically three items. That would be paving, tap fees, and gravity sewer, and just kind of put a little context around there and just ask for, just kind of reflect and to look upon our subdivision as kind of a unique situation. I don't think that we would be setting precedent here tonight if we are to bring forth some of my recommendations here for consideration and setting precedent for other neighborhoods. Number one, let's talk about paving. To Jay's point, you guys graciously extended $450,560 in total exclusion from our assessment. The bid came in, it was $212,500, I believe. So there's still a net difference of $238,000 that you could, unique to our subdivision, exclude from our assessment relative to the initial extension of that $450,000. So my ask of you tonight would be for that consideration of that additional $238,000. I know it was discussed last meeting. I wasn't here last meeting. I think, you know, we tried to explain some math relative to what that looks like. But at the end of the day, you extended $450,000 originally. The winning bid was $212,000. The net difference is potentially unique to our subdivision. Nobody else, not setting precedent, that you could exclude another $238,000 in our assessment. More recent discussions as to tap fee waivers. I know that we've had conversations started with Alderman McClendon relative to what could and could not be allowed relative to state law. I think we've identified that there's no state law that prohibits further tap fee waivers. And so, again, my ask, our ask as a subdivision would be, if we're paying for the infrastructure in the street over 20 years, you know, we're an established subdivision. We have now identified that there are no additional restrictions relative to state requirements that would prohibit further fee waivers. Our ask, again, would be full exclusion of those fee waivers or fees associated with tapping into the system. You did waive graciously two of the four. That still leaves the other two from which to exclude from the assessment. And then lastly, gravity sewer. I think, again, my words to you that we painstakingly, I think, worked together relative to going back, looking at the drawings, having a plumbing company come out and give a second bit of information so that the pipe was dropped in the street. As we understand it today, we don't feel that the city thinks that we're going to have an issue. Now, 3 months from now, when everything's settled and we're able to tap in, my concern is that we don't have a process or a procedure in place to make sure that all of our homeowners, not one of them is disadvantaged relative to having to have extra equipment. So a grinder pump or what have you, I would like to just go on the record and have some sort of process established today if there's one homeowner in our association, 10 homeowners in our association, that has to have extra equipment just to work properly, that the city will be willing to come in to level that playing field so that none of our residents are at a disadvantage. That's the whole intent, I think, of the full gravity system, how it was designed, so that every homeowner in the subdivision would be pretty much in the same situation. So, again, I think our situation is unique. We are coming before you with those requests. I know we are here at this closure date, and so I just want to thank you for the process and the engagement and your consideration tonight, and I certainly appreciate it.
We can pass them down. It'll be fine.
Okay. I only have three of the PowerPoint. I have printer issues. There are more coming.
Go ahead.
Mayor.
State your name. And
Jeremy Smith, five and a half year resident of City of Franklin and vice president of the Homeowner Association. Thank you for your time to hear me speak and your willingness to listen with open minds to the situation. I'm standing before you as not only a voter and a ratepayer, but more importantly as a husband and a father and a homeowner of Monticello that's concerned. All right, and I'm standing before you to ask you to try to remove yourself from the position that you're in and place yourself as a homeowner where you are and think about this situation that's been going on with Monticello for the last 3 or 4 years as a homeowner. All right. I believe that with everything that has transpired over the last number of years, there's been numerous miscommunications involved. If we look at, you know, as far as when you go back and look at the fact that the application was not made from Monticello, all right, for the stimulus funding, okay? We can see the statements that are not true, that easements were supposed to be there before we could apply. Some of these things, we know what they are, okay? What I'm more concerned about is, along with this, on October 12th, it was stated that we were too far along to get the funding. Well, then on October 15th, it was actually stated that we didn't think we would be ready. So were we too far along? Were we not ready? Difference in communications all along the way when it just needed to be done with a simple one-page letter and it had to be submitted for by February 17th. These are the steps that were put in place. These are the steps that were accounted for. These are the steps that were done. This is the letter that was out there. According to everything that was taken care of, we were in complete compliance with what needed to be done. Now, we know that there may not have been a guarantee to get any of the funding. We're aware of that. And we are also aware that, and you know, there has been acknowledgement made that mistakes were indeed made in this process. However, again, were we too far along? Was it too late? When was all this to be done? We're not, there's just been a lot of miscommunication with this. So at the end of the day, what we're looking at is, as a homeowner, forget the economic climate that we're in. Forget that it's tough on a lot of people for a minute. It's about what's right. It's about that there are ways to solve the issue. There are things that we can do to take care of the homeowners in this phenomenal city that we live in. And when you get down to it, this is the cost that we're looking at, average costs, with funding and without funding. All right? There is a significant impact here on what happens if we have funding and if we can get aid from our city or if we do not. All right? We have a sewer system that we're all going to have used to, but no one is going to be able to afford to get into it, and so it's going to sit there idly by and not be used, which will again have another impact on the rest of the homeowners. You know, we appreciate Alderman McClendon and the acknowledgement that some have been made, that there have been mistakes that were made. And unfortunately, these mistakes could have cost us significant dollars to each individual homeowner. What I have an issue with this, and will go on record with, is that if we ran a business like this where we didn't, where we took the mistakes that were made and didn't do anything to rectify the mistakes, the business would lose its reputation, there would not be a strong integrity there, and ultimately the business would probably fail. I don't see that as the City of Franklin's intent at all. I think that they are out here to want to help. And so, in closing, I very humbly ask that you please put yourself in our shoes. Consider how you would feel about the situation if it was you in your own neighborhood, in your own home, and this wasn't done properly. Please ask, you know, you would not sit idly by and just let this transpire. You would do everything in your power to make a strong effort to get relief from the city. Why? Well, because it's the right thing to do. At the end of the day, we're asking very simply for you to do away with the connection fees and absorb the remaining paving cost of approximately $238,000. Great cities don't turn their backs on their people. Thank you.
I'm Donna Rand. I'm president of the Monticello Homeowners Association. And I just want to point out that there are a lot of people wearing red tonight. That's those of us from Monticello. Just wanting to show a sense of unity. As Jeremy says, there's been a lot of correspondence about a lot of our issues. And it seems to me that in many cases there has been a major disconnect between what we were told by previous administrations, by aldermen, and staff. And I don't know that there has been any, there's been intentional, but it's certainly been there. And it's been very hard to, what I've been trying to do as president is understand the process myself and give the best information that I can to the residents, and that's made it really hard when we've been given different information at different times. It makes it confusing for all of us. But in summary, we're asking about the $450,000 that was in the initial estimate from Smith, Segman, and Reed, and in the PowerPoint, which I'm sorry I didn't get enough copies here to begin with, But one page has the SSR estimate for paving, and that was in 2009. And the only mention of paving on this estimate is at the very bottom, and where the $450,560 is referenced. That's the only mention of paving on that estimate. Then when you look at the application for payment number 11, this is from the actual contract. This was the last application. Then we've got different line items. All of a sudden, line 5 appears, and it's $325,000 in paving, and then the rest of the paving cost is at the bottom. So, you know, again, in trying to explain, to understand myself and explain to others how we have the Smith, Seckman, and Reed estimate that has, you know, the line item all at the bottom, and then it's split out. So I think this supports our request for, and the fact that the City of Franklin committed to pay $450,560 of our paving cost. So to me, it's appropriate that we ask that either line 5 be taken out of the assessment, or that we are reimbursed the $238,060 in paving cost. The connection fees. I asked for DVDs of the meetings in January and June of 2009 and July. And in the June meeting, Alderman McClendon stated that it was the intent, and he believed that it was, you know, that BOMA would be in agreement to make the best possible deal for Monticello, that all the fees that state law allowed would be waived. And that was said again several times, and, you know, we believe that. And we believe the reason that all the other fees hadn't been waived was because there was state law. So the assumption there, once you find out there's not one and y'all are wanting to give us the best deal you possibly can, then you're going to want to waive them all. So we request that you do that, and if you're not willing to do it indefinitely, maybe for 3 years, and give us a chance to get tied on without so many upfront costs. And that way we get to use the sewer that's there that we'd like to be able to tap onto. And my last point is about the lien. You know, at first we were told that there would be a waiver that could be put in place so that we could sell our properties and not have to pay the lien off. I mean, and yet this reads that it stands that there's no lien that's going to be before it. So that means that a mortgage company is not going to be behind a lien. They're not going to take second place. So I don't think any title company is going to give clear title without that lien being paid off. And the other thing is, according to the way this still reads, it says that it's delinquent 30 days after it's due and payable, and the whole balance of the improvement shall then become delinquent. And this was something we were told we would have clarification on, and to my knowledge, we have not. I mean, it's still in the ordinance like that. That's a direct copy and paste. So, thank you for your time. That's all I have to say.
Any other comments?
Hello. I'm Nell Henderson. My husband would like to have been here tonight, but due to an illness and surgery, he was not here. He did send a letter to some of the aldermen that he did know. He's lived here for 5 generations. We've seen the change in the growth and development of this community. And I would just like to go back to all the details, the statistics, and everything have already been very well presented by our members on the Monticello board. I've served on the board when we voted for this, worked for it to get through. I'm a biology background person. I also like the idea of the sanitation, the health, and we felt like that our promises would be honored. My husband wrote a letter to you, as he said, assurances by authoritative representatives of the city, though no longer in office, were made to and acted upon by the residents of Monticello. As a retired lawyer, I realize that such assurances are not legally binding on the board, but morally, they are binding on the city. We've lived here a long time, His family has served in city government. His father used to be a judge here. You have to remember the middle-class people. I remember when there was a closing at Bill Moyer's famous published journalist that was on NPT. When our democracy starts not observing the middle class and the division between the wealthy and the poor begins to get more increasingly divided, which I've seen happening in Franklin. I've seen how the wealthy can come down here and change something that had been voted on by the board. And they would have a lot of presence. They have a lot of clout with the developers, and they have infiltrated into a lot of our civic organizations. And this just simply, the Interceptor connection in Simmons Ridge does not serve communities in this family, in this community that are residents there. There are not any buildings out there. There aren't any citizens out there. They've not paid taxes over all these years. They haven't lived there. They haven't devoted a lot of their lives to this community like some of these citizens in our community have. There's retired teachers in our community of Monticello. There's veterans. There are people that have worked in our civic offices. There are 32 retired people. There are 14 widows. As Sunshine Chairman of this community, I have served and molded these people. We've lost four deaths in this community. This is a human face of this decision you're making. These are not statistics on a piece of paper. These are the lives, 100 people, and how it's going to affect their lives. Some of them are in their 90s. Many of them are widows. I talked with one lady on Petite this week, and she said her daughter lives with her because they can't afford to pay all their expenses there. I know of the other three widows that have come in and so on. You're dealing with an older segment of our community, and our president wrote a wonderful letter that I didn't seem to be accepted or not necessarily accepted, but recognize that there's a big difference between communities, the older communities and the newer communities that have 30 years to pay off their debts and 30 years to build that, and they still have jobs. This is a large fee even just for my husband who has a state pension. We have a bill here of $2,950 just to return our plumbing around under our house just to get connected, much less than pay the connection fee. So we have to come up with $5,000 or more plus just to get connected. This is reality, and I hope you will put a human face on this when you make this vote. You can build bridges, build bricks and make the city look beautiful, and you can build things, and that's wonderful. I'm an artist, and I do like aesthetics. But you have to take care of your people. If the rich man builds his house and then forgets to take care of his own family, then he makes a big mistake. This is a real personal decision. And my husband has seen the growth patterns in this town, and he's seen how it's changed. And I do hope this board will have the moral integrity to make the right decision for the people of Monticello. Thank you very much.
Initially, we'd had a discussion about limiting the time limit on some of these comments, and So I may take the prerogative if everybody in the audience is going to speak, I'm going to have to narrow the time limit we're speaking. So,
I promise I won't take too long. My name is David Lawbaugh. I live in the Monticello subdivision at 206 Revere Lane. My wife and I have lived there since 1997. We're one of the properties in the subdivision that has a full basement under the first floor. And as part of that basement, we do have plumbing fixtures. Those plumbing fixtures are a full bathroom. Also, as part of our drainage system, we have pipes underneath the slab that constitutes the floor of our basement. Those pipes all join at the back of our house to go into our septic tank. The reason I wanted to tell you that is because we're one of the people that's going to be affected by the gravity system, whether it works or not. When this whole process started about 3 years ago for me, I started talking to plumbers right away. I said, what should I expect if we have to have a sewer system installed? And they said, well, your access point to where you would hook up to go to the street is going to be so low that if the sewer system is in the street, there's no way that a gravity system will work for you. You're going to have some type of pump to get your sewage to the street from that access point in your house. I've addressed this to the city many times in emails, which you have gotten, and the city's response was, let us do a sewer connection evaluation for you. I said, great. Mr. Chris Bridgewater, who's a senior inspector for the city, came out to my house and did a sewer inspection evaluation. That handout that I've given you is, the first page of it is a letter, which is Mr. Bridgewater's evaluation of my connection. Mr. Bridgewater said, I can make my connection with gravity. During this time period, I've talked to, like I said, about a half a dozen plumbers. All of them said, no, it's not going to work. The second page of that handout is from Jocelyn Plumbing here in Franklin. They have a different opinion based on the city's calculation, and that's what I wanted you to see. If I may, I'd just like to read the last paragraph of the Jocelyn letter to you, just to educate you a little bit on my dilemma. It says, the city's calculations for a gravity connection aren't conclusive. Neither the actual elevations of the sewer line leaving your house nor the elevation of your connection point has been surveyed. Those elevations at this point are guesswork, and there will be no definitive answer as to whether or not you will need a grinder pump until both points are excavated and shot for elevation. When Mr. Bridgewater came out to my house, one of the things he told me is that for every grinder pump that's installed within the city has to have a backup pump in their inventory should that pump fail. He then told me, the city is not in the grinder pump business, and we don't want to be in the grinder pump business, and you will not be allowed to have a grinder pump as part of your connection system. Ladies and gentlemen, I really don't believe that you intended to install and design a sewer system for our subdivision that wouldn't work for all of its residents. I really don't believe that. And I also don't believe that you would make it impossible for some of the residents not to hook up to that in an efficient manner. I don't know. I can't tell from the elevations and the calculations whether this will work or not for me to have a gravity connection, and apparently neither can the city. What I'm asking is that when it comes time for me to hook up to your sewer system, I'd like to be able to do it in the most efficient manner possible. And if that in matter includes having a grinder pump, I would like you to make provision to allow me to have that grinder pump. Thank you for your time.
Any other comments? I declare the public hearing closed. Is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Second.
Discussion. Alderman McClendon.
I move that we exclude from the assessment district the sum of $450,000 representing the paving costs that were budgeted and eventually spent for this project.
Second.
Mayor.
That's an amendment to the motion.
Yes. And I have an explanation that I can address the amendment. The reason for that is because whenever this issue came up, it was my intent to have the Monticello subdivision not bear the burden of the repaving. And I'm not sure when the distinction between the repaving and the patchwork first appeared, but it wasn't before I had committed to the city, to the residents of Monticello, that I wished that they not bear it. And while I understand the two line items, and I understand that why the staff has broken them out the way that they did, that's not what I said I would support. And so, nor did the people of Monticello see the difference until they had committed to be part of the process. So if we had had a discussion that distinguished these two things going early on, one side or the other might have been able to address them differently, but while I disagree with some of the things Mr. Wade said about the order of things happening or the extent to which they say they, that things happen, I do not disagree on this issue that many times the paving costs were represented as excluded. Numbers were attached to that, and people who had to make a decision, they had to take a leap of faith, did so with the paving cost excluded in their mind.
Mr. Mayor, I second the motion because I think it's just the right thing to do. I think this is one of those categories where it is fitting that this, and in agreement with Alderman McClendon, that this is an area which was very maybe gray at one point and then became an additional numbers were added in without a whole lot of discussion or discussion as why that happened. So I'm in favor of waiving it $238,000 because at this juncture it's the right thing to do.
Alderman Barnhill.
If the $238,060 is the net reduction in the assessment district, I think not only have you made a commitment to that, I think there's been other aldermen that have made a commitment to that.
And arithmetically, also, that is the difference.
That is the number, $238,060 reduction in the assessment district.
Any other discussion?
That would be removed from the number that we see $52,066.
It would be $1,052,000 less
$238,060. Alderman Martin.
I am so very sorry to the residents who have been so unhappy with this. I wish that you understood that we're trying to do the best thing for you. I have lived in a house that did not have sewer, and we got it, and we were thrilled about it. And it happened to be right across from your husband, and he got it too. And, you know, I cannot stand to think that all of you folks have come here tonight thinking that we are so bad, because we have tried to do what's best for you, and you will know it in the long run. And I'm so very sorry. I'll vote for this, not because I think it's the right thing to do, because others haven't had to do it. But I will vote for it.
Alderman Peterson.
I guess I do believe that people who made some statements, especially about disallowing all the fees that were not required by state law, did act on their own. They did not act on the boards, any board at the time or now. They gave those assurances by themselves. I will be voting to in favor of the extra $238,000, but I want to say I don't think anyone who does not vote for it is not trying to do what they think is right.
Now would be a good time for a vote.
Alderman Berger.
Yeah.
Well, when we had a Highgate in Country Road, I was, and I'm not speaking for any other alderman here on the board except myself, but when I talked to those people, and if I've talked to any of you, I've been very cautious. I have never promised you anything because at the end, I know numbers change, things change, situations change because it's a very fluid process until you can nail some of these things down. What I don't appreciate is I agree with Margaret. This board does not do things purposely to hurt our residents. I know the people on this board. I know myself. And I take offense to the fact that someone would actually say that the rich people, whatever it was said, infiltrates the board and we favor them. That is so untrue. Mm-hmm. And to make statements like that at a hearing like this just infuriates me and doesn't do anything to help. In fact, it makes me want to vote against it, not for alleviating. It just makes me feel that way because I'm a human being. I have my feelings too. But it's not about feelings in the end. It's about doing the right thing. And I've heard every one of you speak, and I've listened. I've listened to the board members as well. I just feel that I needed to make that clear because I think we're better than that, and I don't think that's necessary. I know these people. These people are people of integrity. Your alderman is a person of integrity as well. I don't think anything has been done purposely to hurt or to do anything disrespectfully or dishonestly. People make mistakes. We have very few under our belt of retrofitting sewer. Highgate was the guinea pig. Believe you me, it was hard on them. We hung in there and we got it done. And I just want to let you know that I'm committed to integrity on this board. And I've listened to my fellow aldermen, I've listened to you, and I will be voting for this.
Could I make one more comment? I may agree with some of your comments. But
a question, what will be the source of the difference in this money?
It'll go to the general rate fund, the sewer fund, so
it ought to go to streets. It ought to go to streets.
It's part of the sewer project. It'll go to the sewer project.
It can't go to streets.
So the total difference now is $238,000.
You're adding $238,000 there. I would just point out one other thing, just out of the consideration as we look at what has happened in other projects. This paving repair cost that is associated with these just roughly runs anywhere from 20% to 50% of the cost of these projects. That's just it's a significant component of carrying out the retrofitting of neighborhoods for sewers. So, you know, one of the things we need to look at, and when this project is done, I would strongly suggest that the board spend some time together on not just a policy, but a chapter in your municipal code that defines how you're going to do these projects. So there's not a sense of, is it a moving target? Is it whatever discussion happened 5 years ago, 6 years ago? It's codified. And so I would urge you in the next month or so that we do this when everything is fresh in everybody's minds and that we kind of have that discussion. That's something I would urge you to do so that we can maybe not have some of the feelings and discussions we're having tonight.
Absolutely. Do you want to make one additional comment?
I wouldn't.
I kind of laid it off.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Excuse me.
So what will be the retroactive expense if we also offer this to...
There wasn't any.
Were there any other that...
If you're talking about paying for the paving costs and every other project that it was included in the construction, you look at the chart that's at the back of your packet.
I think he's talking about Highgate and the others.
Is here.
Yeah, there's a number here. It's probably $150,000.
Are we prepared to offer the same deal to those?
No.
Are we going to have groups here after this group asking for retroactive relief?
Probably.
Sure.
Yeah.
So we're going to increase this by then another $158,000 for our rent savings?
Just chop off a million.
That's going to be your call in terms of how you handle that. We've done these projects a little bit different every time, it seems.
But this amount will be spread across the board for all sewer rate payers?
Exactly. Yes. It'll be absorbed
by
the fund.
We're going to be paying.
Alderman Peterson, are you done? Alderman Clinton.
Call the question.
I'm not done.
Second.
All in favor of calling the question?
Aye.
Opposition? Let's see.
Me. Opposition. About calling the question?
Yeah. On the paving issue.
We have staff wants to make a comment.
Let's vote.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? None. So we're ready to vote.
This was the paving.
For the pavement.
No.
No, where are we?
No, we just we're ready to vote on the amendment.
Right.
At this point in time.
I called the question on the amendment.
Yes, we're ready to vote on the amendment.
Right. The paving, yeah. The deduction of $238,000. Oh, that's it. And we, you said all in favor, and everybody but Mike said aye.
Yeah. Correct.
Okay.
Correct. So.
Before you, you voted on the amendment, right?
Yes. No, we have not voted on the amendment. All in favor of the amendment? Say aye.
Aye. And just because our minute taker is unclear.
Slow down.
The net effect is minus 238.
238.
The overall paving exclusion is 450. Yes, they're both right.
All opposed.
Actually, 237.
Alderman Skinner.
So let's get the number on these.
Just, if you don't mind, I would like to just clarify that the total net effect is not just a 238.60. We also have to reduce, and we will be reducing, the finance interest charge, which is a small amount added to that. So it'll be a little bit less than you subtract the 238.60 plus a little bit more.
Plus the interest.
I just want to make sure you're all aware of that before when I come back with it. It's going to be less than what you may be thinking. So
paving's coming out.
All right. Let's vote on the amended motion now.
Okay, I have another one.
So what? Another amendment?
Another amendment.
Yep. Because I said I would. I move that we waive the connection fees, tap fees, system development fees for the Monticello Assessment District.
Proper motion. Is there a second? Motion. The amendment dies for lack of a second. Are we ready to vote on the amended motion now?
So do we have a number on it?
It's $1,052,000 less roughly $238,000.
Which takes it down to about, oh shoot, I had the number.
And as Dave said, whatever interest is on
about $814,000, it'll be a little bit less because there's a 0.8% financing cost that we have built in, the cost of financing it all. So it's...
That's it.
It's a
810, 814,000. Yeah, 814,000.
All in favor of the amended motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed to the amended motion, say aye.
Okay.
Alderman Skinner opposes.
All right. Mr. Mayor, can I state one thing about just process for folks, just because we have a group here very interested in this? The billing related to this will start in April. This neighborhood actually has a unique opportunity in that you sort of have an interest-free period between now and August 31st. You can decide to pay off in full. If you've made monthly payments between then and the end of August, what you've paid will be applied to the principal. So the timing of this vote gives you sort of a unique opportunity between now and the end of August within which you can go ahead and start making a monthly payment if you so choose. That's calculated out based on a 20-year 4%. But you've actually had this opportunity between now and August 31st that if you decided to pay off in full, that would all be applied to the principal of your lien. There was also a question last time about how the billing process exactly would work. You will receive a separate bill for your assessment. It will not be put in with your water and sewer bill. You will not have your water cut off for not paying the assessment. Those two are separate issues. But if you do not pay your assessment, it'll go just like a normal bill that isn't paid goes. You would get notice from us. You would receive multiple notices. At some point, it would be turned over to our city attorney to pursue. And ultimately, would be brought to this board if it's still not paid, for a decision about pursuing legal matters to pursue the collection of the lien overall. That's just how that would work, but that would, you know, there would be a lot of notice between that. There would be the opportunity for the board to decide specifically about pursuing anything related to the collection and how that might work. So I just wanted to be clear on that because there had been a reference to to some uncertainty about that issue, and I wanted to be go through those details and let people know kind of where that stands from here.
I have a question.
Sure.
On that, I believe at one point it was stated that if you're delinquent a certain number of days, you would have the full amount of the lien due and payable. However, whenever I requested and got, and I think everybody did, a comment, you know, the code on that, to me, when I read it, it indicated that your yearly amount would be due and payable. And I would like for that to be checked, because that is the way I interpreted it. That's what it said in the code, and I certainly think we need to get that cleared up.
Need to move on to item 12. Can we have already voted on the motion? And
yeah. There.
Please do.
Yeah, we can address that.
Yeah. Item 12, consideration resolution 2011-15, a resolution authorizing the City of Franklin's application for phase one of the hazard mitigation grant program in response to the May 2010 presidential disaster declaration. Is there a motion?
I so move.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Motion passes unanimously. Number 13, consideration construction bid award to Doss Brothers Incorporated for the demolition of 306 Fifth Avenue North in the amount of $9,200. Is there a motion?
Move approval.
Second.
Alderman Bransford, you got it? Good. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes unanimously. Number 14, consideration of construction bid award to Doss Brothers Incorporated for the demolition of 11 Rebel Meadows properties as part of the Mac Hatcher Parkway Extension Project in the amount of $76,000. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Alderman Martin, and then Alderman Bransford. Any discussion?
I have a question.
Yes.
When we remove these structures, homes, we are doing so in a well-established, stable neighborhood of people that live there and call it their home. What will they be left with? I mean, it's one thing to remove these structures. Are we going to seed it, mow it, we're going to have Parks Department out there running down from Fieldstone Park to mow it regularly. I mean, you know.
Yes.
Yes?
We'll take down the structures.
We'll take the structure down. We take all asphalt paving is to come out. It will be seeded, strawed, and we're not going to sod it.
Okay.
We're not going to go to that expense. But then it will be maintained as far as either by Parks or Street Department for cutting the grass, et cetera.
We'll cut and maintain the lots.
Yes. Okay.
Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Pass unanimously. Number 15, consideration of the dedication of easements on city property to Middle Tennessee Electric Membership Corporation for the relocation of electric lines for the Hillsborough Road Improvement Project. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes unanimously. Number 16, consideration of amendment number one, Hillsborough Road intersection improvements at Claude Yates Drive. T-DOT.
That's mine.
Is there a motion?
Moved.
So moved.
Is there a second?
No, you have to
is
have
there a
clarification.
Second?
Yes.
Why do I need clarification?
Because it needs to be approved with clarification of language to the legal department.
Oh, yeah,
that's
that.
True.
Would you like to restate your
well, that
motion?
Goes without saying. Everything has to be cleared by legal.
Would you restate your motion?
The motion is that we approve this with subject to legal's approval of the language in the contract.
Right. I will second that as well.
Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes unanimously. Number 17, consideration of professional services agreement with Sane Associates for the waterline relocation design as part of the Mac Hatcher Parkway widening northeast quadrant project in an amount not to exceed $15,000. Is there a motion?
I move for approval with the staff final decision on this.
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? No opposition. Passes unanimously. Number 18, consideration of contract award to Cheryl Morgan of Covington, Kentucky in the total amount of $30,000 for the initial 12-month term of service year for group employee insurance benefits consulting services for the Human Resources Department with options to extend the term of service for up to a maximum of 2 additional 1-year terms. Is there a motion?
Move that we defer this matter to either finance or capital, probably finance.
Second.
My reason for that, Mayor, is we have until, I know that this is a matter we need to get to work on, but as I understood the proposal, it was open for acceptance until July.
We have to, the bids, the what we have in terms of an insurance program expires July 1. We need to go through a bidding process. We need to prepare those documents for bid.
Okay.
We really, the reason this is put on both agendas is we want to have this in place so that we can move forward now and get working on this and get the bids and the necessary paperwork out. I would urge that we take action. I don't know that deferral is going to do us any good, and we'll lose time in our process here.
We have a motion with a proper second. Any other discussion?
But budget is next week.
Budget and finance is next week.
Yeah.
CIP is
CIP is Thursday.
But it's already been.
CIP is published.
Yeah, published.
It would, and it's more appropriate for budget anyway.
I'm going to support the motion.
I will
do. I'd rather see it go. I'd rather see
what information will we have for finance that we don't have now?
Mm-hmm. I'd like to see the RFP.
Giving you everything.
Yeah, I'm going to see the RFP too.
We gave you the RFP.
Any other discussion?
Can I speak to this just
sure,
a little
go
bit?
Ahead.
I want to comment a little bit. We went through a very thorough professional procurement process. It took a lot of time to do this and review it at a staff level. This is consistent with the way we have managed our benefits in the last 5 years. And I take exception to a characterization that Mr. Drury made earlier, where he has a right to his opinion, but the management and the approach we've taken has saved over $6.5 million in the last 5 years in our benefits program. This is a continuation of that same approach. We are using some additional consultant services, which we have done in the past, to help us craft the bid documents and to strategize about where we go with insurance. There are new considerations that we want to make sure we're fully appreciating and taking into account as we move forward. I think time is of the essence. I'd ask you to support our recommendation of the bidder that was identified as lowest and best. I believe we put forth a good process and one that I stand fully behind. And I would ask you to put confidence and us moving forward and using these services and taking the action we need to do so that we're ready to bid this and be in a good position to have the right benefits programs in place to cover our employees come July.
Mayor.
I've got Clyde first.
In answering and in commenting to Eric's some of the statements, I think that probably 95% of the time, Eric, you've seen that the board and we and I have supported staff's recommendations. But I got to tell you, I'm not comfortable with this. I'd prefer that this go back to the committee. It's next week. It's a 2-week delay that we're looking at on this. The motion's been made to defer it back to the committee. It did not come through that process. Even though there's money budgeted for that, $30,000 or whatever was budgeted in the budget, if you're not comfortable with it, you're just not comfortable with it. That's not a reflection on you, staff, or anybody else. It is a reflection somewhat on the timing of this and what appears to be the urgency of this. And for it to be, and to be honest with you, unless somebody has heard, if there's another argument, this is basically yesterday when I got the agenda was basically the first time I had seen this, and that should not be that kind of urgency. one day before the board meeting, and there's a vote, and there's a works, and there's a work session, don't it? And if I'm wrong on having seen it earlier, and should have seen it earlier, then I apologize to whoever I should apologize to. But that's my comments. That's my personal comments. I'd still rather see this be back to the committee, and I don't think that that two-week delay would just kill us insofar as the bidding and the insurance programs that we've got to go through.
Alderman McClendon.
Like Alderman Barnhill, I have found that most of the time that a collection of our staff makes a recommendation, eventually I agree with it. So this is not a criticism or indictment of the process that staff engaged in, and I would expect that Mr. Stuckey would feel strongly about the recommendations that he's put his name on. Yeah. I would expect nothing less. And I am perfectly willing to believe that in the end I will agree. I am just not able to come to that conclusion with comfort at the moment. As Alderman Barnhill said, these things sometimes come upon us quickly, and it's a, I don't doubt that it'll survive scrutiny for 2 weeks and everything will be fine.
Alderman Martin.
I understand what you're saying, but I believe that there's not, we got a bunch of smart people up here, but I don't think anybody up here has the knowledge and the ability to make these decisions like our staff. We've got a wonderful staff, and I would go with the recommendation of the staff without question.
Alderman Berger had her hand up before you, Alderman Skinner, and then you.
When are we meeting for finance and budget? What's the date on that? 17th?
17th.
Can we put it on the voting session for the 22nd and take it to finance and budget and vote on it in 2 weeks? I mean, if we're looking at time, we're concerned about time. It just delays us 2 weeks. Plus, we have to have this done by July.
Is it possible to...
Our current contract is up in July. We will have to enroll all employees in every line of benefits because this is the year to bid them out.
These are the consulting services that help us bid it. We got to build the whole bidding process.
Right. We'll have to put out an RFP or request for proposal for all of the lines of the employees' insurance. Then we will have to enroll them. Normally, we try to enroll in May or June. It is just 2 weeks, and once again, I apologize that we didn't get it here earlier, and I will take full credit for that. I've been out since November, so I do apologize. We can try. I don't know that we'll have the time to use the consultant, but that's totally your call.
I've got Alderman Skinner and Alderman Peterson.
I just want to reflect what Shirley said. Things always take longer than you think. There are a number of steps that have to happen. We have to put out more RFPs. We have to get the people assigned, and we have to do all that before the end of June. Why scrunch them? Because we're not going to have any more information when we vote on this again than we have now.
Let me add one other piece, if I can, just to the information. We've spent a lot of time. We haven't really talked about as much who we've selected. Cheryl Morgan is an extensive qualifications. They're doing this work for about 50 other cities, and they include cities in this region, Murfreesboro, Brentwood, Columbia.
Mr. Stuckey, this is exactly the kind of information that would provide me the comfort that I need to endorse this recommendation.
I didn't hear that.
Okay. This is something I did not know. So Mr. Skinner is wrong. Apparently, I will know more.
Mm-hmm. You do now.
Alderman Peterson.
You know it now. I'm supporting the motion because it did not go through the regular committee process. I understand time frames and that this was a special circumstance. However, I do not think that we, in spite of our confidence in the
city staff can say that we will always support the city staff recommendations, mm-hmm. even if it, in the long run we find out some things that we might support. There are some other times, though, whenever there are considerations that we need to make the decision on, not the city staff. And as I say, because this didn't go through the committee process, I would like to see it go.
Alderman Bransford.
I just want to try to echo what the administrator was talking about, is that I need to hear more about this, the vendor that we have chosen, that you are recommending, because I need to know that, hear that, feel that. I just didn't get that in the work session.
I understand. You want to make another comment?
One comment. I would like to be assured that the vote would be on 2 weeks from tonight.
Yeah. Right. If it's not in 2 weeks, then we
might as well pull.
Then
the
it's moved.
Yeah, we need to review if 2 weeks even is a problem, and we'll let you know.
Well, what if we want to vote tonight?
Well, then don't vote for the deferral that's on the table.
Deferral.
The motion that's on the floor now is for deferral to budget and finance.
And then that's 2 weeks from now on the 22nd vote.
Okay.
It's two parts.
Yes.
So is that part of the motion? That
yeah, I want it on the next opportunity that we can support, you know, vote, yeah. Be here.
Budget,
vote.
Finance, and also on the board of Mayor Alderman. So everybody's clear on the motion?
Sure. Does it? I make sure that the administrator knows what he's supposed to be providing to us.
I hope by.
Okay.
We'll do our very best.
Okay.
All in favor of deferring to budget and finance, and then voting on it at the next Board of Mayor and Alderman meeting on March the 22nd, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. We have two opposed. So, out in the audience, Linnea and Linda and Sarah, thank y'all for y'all's hard work tonight. And I would look for a motion to adjourn.
Don't we have to move?
No executive session.
No executive session.
That's my treat.